Hey guys, it's Mark Oakley here again with another episode of From the Drawing Board, and thought I'd draw some Thieves and Kings today. I had this page that I finished off recently, and it's time to get on with the new scene. So I went ahead and laid out the next page. This is the page that is up on Patreon among two or three others. Little sequence where we're introducing Quentin's new outfit. Times are changing in the Thieves and Kings world. Whenever there's a big shift in history, all the indicators change along with it. And one of the indicators is just sort of how the characters look. And I decided that Quentin's going to be wearing a black suit. And he's coupled up with Lyanna, one of the Sword Maidens. So these two oddball characters they've come together, and they've really allowed me to explore this really interesting theme, which is one that's cropped up many, many times in Thieves and Kings, which is the idea and the problem of writing for immortal characters. Except these two are interesting because they have very poor recall. Like, they're aware that they've been around for thousands of years. Quentin's much older than Lyanna, but Lyanna, you know, she was born, you know, way back at Serratia's genesis. You know, when Serratia was a human woman, she, conscripted these two girls and took their souls and baked them into her two, you know, dread swords, the Shadow Pair. And upon their release, after, you know, the last five books of adventure, they were free. And I thought, well, Kim, she's sort of bonded to Rebellion Heath, and we sort of followed her story a little bit. Her friend is, I always sort of showed her as just sort of this narcissistic, this strange, sociopathic, crazy, rather violent, soulless girl. And that's been altered. Like, she has her soul fully, you know, collected back in this body. And now she and Quentin are working together. It's not where I expected to end up, but it's proven a fascinating piece of story. It's kind of interesting, like, you know, the weapons that Serratia brought into the world to divide it and make it her own have become separated and given one each to two different parties, and so they're being wielded in different ways. And Quentin is a fascinating character who, despite his vast age, his memory just is full of blank spots and is very spotty, and he's not entirely sure of, well, we're not entirely sure of how much he remembers and how much he knows in a given moment. He's a chaos god, or the god of creativity, sort of just without any direction. And Lyanna is all about direction. She's directed force. That's what she's spent her life learning. And so they've sort of come together to sort of learn from each other in this fascinating relationship. I'm just going to explore where it goes. Anyway, on her direction, or sort of on his direction too, he's like, you know, you need some new clothes. Your last outfit has been blown up. It's all burned around the edges. And his had, been worn down rather a lot too over the centuries. So today, you know, they're reforming each other, and I don't think the city or the world quite realizes how much power is bound up between these two. They're like, they're two nuclear weapons walking to the city, and they don't realize it. We're going to put them into some combat situations later. I've got some cool scripts in the future, but right now they're deciding who they are going to be. The clothes make the man, you know, and their outward expression is going to mirror who they feel like they are inside and who they want to be. And so this is that genesis, and I found it fascinating. I get to sort of explore. I have Quentin deciding, I'm not going to wear a tie. Ties are symbols of bondage. You know, they're like a little, it's like a leash, right? So he pulls that off, and he's like, no, I am unbound. And then he goes to take his shoes off, and I'll let you read the pages when they come out. I quite like them. Anyway, Lyanna's like, no. You know, she takes charge of this situation, and I can talk a fair bit about that. I'm not going to. But Quentin's been told off and commanded, this doesn't happen very often. I mean, Heath could do it at her most powerful points, back in that little Walking Mage book that I did a long time ago, which is sort of like political satire. We saw the kind of power relationship, the dynamic that the two held, where Quentin is by far the more powerful being, and Heath was the sort of the more the visionary one, the one who understood how things fit together, and they moved through the world in that way and kept each other, you know, safe and in balance. And that relationship has moved into different quarters. Heath isn't there anymore. And so there's this new girl, and she's just taking on that role or sort of figuring her way through it. And she is just given her first real command, and it's through comedy that it happened. And Quentin acquiesces, but he's going to be doing it in it. I like the fact that it's a balanced maneuver because it came about very naturally in the scripting. I thought it was funny and kind of charming and innocently, like, you know, she's not deciding how do I dominate this powerful creature, and yet sort of her instinctive feminine side is like, well, there's a lot of force here, and in order to survive it, I have to place myself in a way where I have, you know, there's a control surface that that I know how to integrate with. And he needs this, and he sort of, you know, it's a little annoying to have someone tell you that you can't grow cheese in your between your toes, but you sometimes need someone to tell you that, because you can get, you know, he's vaguely aware as his soul is growing that he doesn't know all the correct answers, and having someone who's very clear allows him to sort of navigate his own path, and this is what they're providing for each other anyway. So the next panel is just him sort of recovering from this big shift in their relationship, or this big sort of milestone which has been reached. And so that's what I'm drawing. So he'll be sitting and contemplating, and she'll be standing, huffing, and they're both sort of thinking, well, what just happened there? That was that was a pretty big deal. So let's draw that. I'm gonna get the screen nice and clear. And there's my canvas. Ah. Oh. I love this drafting board. It really allows me a good space to just real. I mean, that's a big area. Like, the area that I'm looking at is about this big. That's a nice space to do a drawing. All right, so I'm going to draw her first, and we're going to draw him down here, and they're both just sort of looking at each other. Mm-hmm. And I love this hat that she's wearing, this big floppy sort of, looks like sort of that Carmen Sandiego hat, except maybe not quite as sharp. It was meant to be sort of a summer hat, and it's very, very light. And this is what she wants to experience. She wants summer clothes. This is like a new part of her life. She spent so much time being just dark and scary and terrifying and influenced by Serratia, who is all about exerting power. Where's my, yeah. Through fear and intimidation. And this is like a fresh feel for her, because when her soul was sort of unbound, Trisha came to visit her in the last chapter of the First Apprentice's book, and just took all the little hooks that led all the way back to the dark side, and said, "Okay, you're free now. You get to choose. Those things aren't sucking your energy and directing you." And so she felt this lightness, and just like, "Oh wow, she's never felt that before." It's kind of like, you know, getting a really good supplement for the first time and go, oh wow, I didn't realize my body could feel this good. So let's see, is that too big? It might be, but let's just draw a pretty girl. How does her outfit look? Let's go back one and see. So it's got like a triangular V-neck and a little rim here. Oh, you know what I didn't do? She's supposed to have sort of socks that go like this. I'm gonna have to go back and edit that. That's what those are supposed to look like, but we'll leave that for now. So I think she's going to have her arms crossed over her chest. It's a little too large. I wanted to get a shot of both of them in full pose from head to toe. So I'm going to shrink that down a touch. Just put that there. Digital's great that way. That would have been like, I have to erase this and redo it. Although sometimes scale isn't really a problem on paper. It's much easier to sort of get an eyeball of things because you're not constantly changing the size of your canvas. You can't zoom in and out of reality, right? Whereas this thing, it can get big and small, depending, on the needs of the moment. But man, it forces you to like really. You got to learn some new visual awareness skills. You don't come. It's unnatural to see your paper grow and shrink. So all the drawing learning that I did when I was growing up needs to be updated. And I don't know if I've quite done. I'm getting better at it. But let's see here. Does that work? It doesn't look right at all. Let's fix that. One of the things I set my canvas up to do was you can see how there's this big gray box around the page. I can draw right onto that, That's this is all canvas because I just was finding like when I only could draw on the page itself, it was really, stressing me out, man. Like, if you needed to do lines of perspective, you're going, oh, I need to make a building, how do I get these lines of perspective to work? So there's your horizon line, and if the thing went off the page, you couldn't do it. You'd end up with your workspace is just limited. So I thought, well, you know what? I've got like 16 gigabytes in the memory of this computer that's running everything. Surely that's enough to hold more than just the actual page that I need. So I thought, yeah, I'll just make a ridiculously huge canvas. And then when it comes time to edit the page, I'll just cut it out, right? And also, I started drawing, like really overcompensating in terms of pixel depth. Because I figure, if you draw a really nice picture, and I decide, oh, I really like this image, I want to make that into, let's say, a poster. You can blow it up, but because it's raster graphics as opposed to what is it, vector. Like vector, you put down numbers and you can infinitely zoom in. Here, you zoom in and it just gets pixelated if you get in really close, which is the good way. I like drawing that way. I find vector is kind of like trying to create through the lens of an AI. I'm like, no, I want really direct feedback. So when I put down a pixel, that's the pixel I put, but when I look at my old Jenny pages, like way back when I had 2 gigabytes to work with, not 16, size was an issue. And so I was right up against the dividing line between, well, when I go on a printed page, say you print a comic page, you want to have it at a high enough resolution so that to the naked eye, the lines look smooth. There's no sort of like stepping on the lines. And you're like, okay, well, if I do it at, say, 300 dots per inch, that's kind of the absolute limit. If it goes any lower than that, you're beginning, oh, I can see dots. So I would say, well, let's comfortably go to 600 dots per inch. Oh, but then you're kind of like, oh, that's pushing the memory. So what if I'm at 450? That's a little higher, So I was really, really just dancing on the edge of that. And now, with memory being cheap and computers being faster, I've decided to just make it huge. So I want to show you something. This is really funny. So here's a, there's That's a Thieves and Kings page. That'd be one comic page. And I'm going to open up an old Jenny page, just to sort of so I can show you. We'll go back way back to chapter 2 and find a good page here. Let's see. Let's go to one of the digital ones, because I started off drawing that on paper and scanning. Let's see here. Here's a nice one. All right. Is that a good one? I think that's a good one. All right. So there we are. There's a Jenny page. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to select it, copy it, and I'm going to just bring it over into here so you can see how big it actually is. Are we, in fact? Come on, then. Copy. And paste. There it is. So look at that. It's like a quarter of the size. Not, it's even smaller. And this this Jenny page here, that'll print, you know. I originally designed the Jenny pages to fit in like a digest size, like sort of the, you know, like the size of the Stardrop books, so about that big. And this is a good resolution for that. But when we zoom in, it's not bad, actually. I was drawing in Photoshop at the time, which didn't do sort of super clean lines, but you can see the stepping at this level, right? Now the resolution is like four times greater. So for one of these pages, when we zoom in, let's zoom into Quentin emancipating himself. You got to get a lot tighter before you start seeing the stepping, right? And that is a teeny, that's like the size of an eyelash. It's, so you can kind of zoom out forever. So yeah, you get to be very, very wasteful, or not. It is, it's unnecessarily big. I don't have to be this high res, but I just like it. And I figure, you know, you're sort of future-proofing yourself. Like, what if you need to print this the size of a building? I don't know why you'd ever want to do that, but you want to have the option, right? So so that's what that's, that was doing. Anyway, let's get back to drawing. All right. So let's see here. Doesn't quite look correct, does it? It looks a little weird. Let's adjust for that, see if we can't make it look a little. And also her head's too big. That's part of the problem. I still get scale. You know, I find it challenging. I think I was better at it when I was purely on paper. Just because, again, you're not having to adjust on the fly for your canvas getting bigger and smaller. So when you draw, everything's. But now our legs are too large. It's what a strange image. She looks funny. All right. Let's shrink these a bit here. Whoops. How's that? That looks nice. There she is. Maybe. Let's move that a touch over here. Nope. You know what I'm gonna do? I find I do this a lot. I don't know why, but I find my characters are tipping often. And so I have to, you know, I find this helps. There. I don't know why I do that. I'm always just a little off center gravity-wise, you know? Did that happen? Did I just... Oops. There we go. All right. And I am gonna draw socks on her. How high up do they go? Reference time. I can guess at it, but you just I find like when you first invent like a new outfit or a new character, you spend all this time getting them perfectly designed, and then 10 pages later you compare the two and your instincts have sort of smoothed the edges off and there's this real difference. But I like to always, you know, to go back to the original, just to remember what was my intention. Let's try and get back to that. You don't want to have like significant details just sort of vanish, and I've done that already. I've lost her socks. All right, so here's... Oh yeah, I know. There was a shot of her showing off her new outfit. And we're going to load that up. There we are. So there she is. Gosh, it sure looks different already. Like, it had sort of sharper edges. It was, I would guess I was thinking more like a coarser material, but it became sort of more floppy. I love this page. Quentin waking up in the clothing store. I don't know if you guys have ever experienced that. I've gone shopping with girls who love shopping, you know, and you're just, and they have like the boyfriend chairs in the back of these girls' clothing stores. And you'll just like sit there because you're so bored and you're just like, we've been here for an hour. Can we go? I'm just, you feel like you start turning into a 3-year-old, right? Like you and your mom shopping. You're just like, I feel like I've been here for an infinity amount of hours. I have to get out. I was shopping once with a girlfriend, and she was a real fashion goddess. You know, she loved this sort of thing. And I learned at that point that they, you know, malls and you know, boutique kind of stores, they understand this pattern. And so you go to the back of the shop and they'll have like these chairs thoughtfully put out for the boyfriends. And more often than not, you'll see another guy and he's just sitting there looking like, just like, you know, call the police, like, or just defeated, and he's exhausted, but he's putting in his time as a good boyfriend. So you kind of like, and you don't want to talk to him. You don't want to like acknowledge. It's sort of like it's a shared, you know, yeah, this is really embarrassing. I recognize what you're up to, and I'm doing the same thing. Let's not talk about this ever again. But you kind of sit there and kind of just sort of like doze, and that's what Quentin was doing. And then he's called over to take a look. So I thought that was a funny thing. And anyway, what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab this and we're going to edit, copy, close that up, don't save, and here she is. And here's the other nice thing is like when I have these edges, I have somewhere to put like the clip art and reference material, so it's not getting in the way when I'm trying to draw, so I can, you know, quickly look back and forth. So I've made her dress a little poofier and a little shorter, and I'm gonna go with that because I think it's nice, and it's not quite as sharp. There's a few suggestions of lines, and I want to sort of use those line suggestions to sort of suggest sort of where her legs are underneath. There she is, and is this sort of, whoops. All right, maybe just a hint of like the little bow on her hat up there. All right, her shoes have these little, there's like a little white piece of material along the top. I'm not sure I like that. I may evolve that out of existence, but we'll keep it for now. Looks like she's turning her ankle there a little bit. We don't want that. Shoes are funny because often they're pointing directly at you, and so you're doing all this weird foreshortening on a pretty strange shape. Feet are funny objects. There she is. Okay. That doesn't look right. Those legs look funny. Let's try again. In fact, I'm going to give up on those, even though they kind of worked. Let's try again. It's a bit better. Revisit that. All right, good enough for now. Good enough for now. All right, Quentin, what are you doing? Let's have you I like it. Okay, so he's just sitting here looking up at her. Is that how we want to do this? So much is, like, there's only one word balloon in this panel, but there's a lot of communication going on. There's a lot of important thought processes that I want to get across. There's potential for this panel to be quite, not powerful, but I don't like there to be wasted panels in a comic book. You know, I want there to be an emotional snippet that everyone, you know, look at a pen and go, oh yeah, I know exactly what they're feeling. That's the goal you want for each. See, that's not right. He looks too sad there. What is the expression that we want here? He's just been told off. Is he could be sort of like, or he could be like, a little bit cowed. Let's have a look here. Where did it come from? He's going from happy and she's, you know, disgusted. She tells him off and he's like, okay, sheesh. What do you do right after that? What's the next domino that falls emotionally, like a second later or a few seconds later? All right. It could be this. Let's try this one. He could be sort of like kind of going, kind of rolling his eyes. Mm-hmm. don't think we're going to do that. That's not quite what I was after. Take a bit of work to get there. Or he could be sort of looking at the camera. That's a little bit of a cheat, right? It's a little bit of a fourth wall cheat. It's worth doing every now and then. It can sometimes be effective, and it always seems to sort of work. He's like looking at you, kind of going, you know, that sort of silent communication between you and the, you know, between the reader and him. I'd never do this, but, you know, like, look what I have to put up with. Never. That's not a Thieves and Kings maneuver. We're not doing this either. I think I know what to do. What we're going to do. Is this. This is one of those pictures where I might find myself redrawing it as several times as the page develops. Because you try a couple things, you read it in context, and then you go, no, that doesn't quite work. And you run the scene back and forth. There's a few, like, you know, a little 5-second scene. You kind of go back and forth and you roll it forward, roll it back. What feels right, what doesn't feel right. And then the sort of the cast of his shoulders makes a difference. Like if they're sort of up, he's like a little bit more defensive. If they're down, he's more like a scolded puppy. Oh, and the slightest line weight can make a difference. So when I go to ink, expressions can change from what I had in the penciling process. I love this kind of stuff, this sort of exploration. You're working on so many levels. Like you're working just, you know, as a pencil guy. So you're just like, oh yeah, how can I realize the physical objects that are in front of me? But you're emotionally exploring your own feelings and your own reactions to the stimulus that was provided in the scene. And you're figuring, well, how do I feel? And then you have to go, well, it's not me though. This is Quentin. How does he feel? So now you're doing sort of backstory for him. And it's all just to get just the right expression. In text, it's a similar process, but it's not, the feedback isn't so direct. Like you draw it here and you can see it. And you go, yeah, I can feel it. I can empathize. Faces are so powerful that way. How does that look? Is that kind of getting it across? It's a little too much. He's not defeated. That could work. I'd have to read it in conjunction with the scene that came directly before. That might not be appropriate. It would be really easy to sort of have him like, oops, to have him sort of a little bit ticked off. Oh, he's going to put up some resistance. He doesn't want to be told what to do. And that's actually appropriate. I mean, he is a god, right? He's been around for a long, long time. But, you know, so he's used to getting his own way. But at the same time, he's also very vulnerable, right? He's that much sort of creative power inside a person by necessity opens them up to, like, I don't know, the ether of emotional power. Like you can't create unless you can sort of feel. And feeling means that things hurt. And so his soul is available, or what passes for a Quentin soul is available to be rocked in that way. So he's feeling a number of emotions going through. But I do like this little, I don't know, man, the little squiggle over his head. We don't have those in the real world, but when did these things get invented? What a great, it's just a little squiggly line, and it's like there's like actual, you know, rays of annoyance or confusion, or, you know, like his thought balloon has popped, and there's the thoughts are just ended, and it's kind of like it's just a piece of smoke now, you know. We don't have those in the real world, and yet we understand them. I think that's marvelous. All right, I think that might be. Oh, I think I could do something else with his body. Let's try this. Like, he could even be sort of like, you know, have one arm up on a knee like this. Or so that gives a different kind of feeling to what he's it says something more about what's going on internally. That could work. And one of his shoes is actually off, so I'm going to draw that over here. That'll be fun. I'll draw like a little, just a shoe off to one side. No, I'm not going to put the little thing above that. It'll just be there. I'm going to change his eye just a touch. I don't think that works. He's not, I don't think he's annoyed. It doesn't quite flow. I'll have to experiment with that a little bit. Anyways, we've been recording for, I think, long enough. It's a nice little, you know, two characters annoyed with each other. I think that sort of works. I'll play with this some more and see what I come up with, and you'll get to see the solution that I invented. But this has been sort of my process for now. So you can, let's finish that off. I'll bring that up a touch. I think he might be too big. Let's get his scale just a little bit smaller there. All right. And he's sitting on this like curb, so I get to draw like more buildings, some sidewalk. Yeah, we're gonna go with that for now. For now. I'm not convinced that I'm going to stick with it, but the rest of the scene is really nice. I like to have every page kind of contain a single beat, so you get to the end, you go, oh yeah, that was a fun little interaction, and it readies you for the next page. Anyway, I think that's enough for now. I'm going to save this. Oh, I didn't save even once while drawing. I should know better by now after so many years of doing this. And that's what I've been up to. So we're going to call that a video for this afternoon, and I hope you're all doing really, really well, and I hope you have a great day or evening wherever you are. Hit like and subscribe if you like this kind of stuff, and I'll catch up with you guys in another video real soon. All right, cheers, bye.